בוא פעם פועל עתיק ל... עתיק ל... בוא פעם יוטיוב And then I'll tell them,
GWAD. I could set it for just a short on the PlayStation. They have a whole
Is it for your profile right now?
Yeah. Right now, this one's.
Because muscle weigh more than fat. and I've lost muscle and gained fat in its place, so I probably weigh less than what I used to.
Well, I don't lose no muscle and I still gain fat.
I need to weigh more.
I know I did that. I lose the muscle and turn into fat. No, I still do enough fat enough to maintain my arm.
I still
rock hard. But I don't need that.
My muscle mass come back quick though. So
I don't need that. I need the friggin' the
cardio.
Yeah. I need to get on a bike and ride.
I don't need cardio. I have to turn my fat into muscle and I'll still be the correct size. You're not still streaming, are you?
Probably. I am still streaming. Why?
What's wrong with you?
Because no, actually, listen, no, when you're the pump, this is tough. When you go pump the main thing, pause. See, you say the thing mark pause, the video pause?
Yeah.
Then you go back on, then you come back on.
Wait, is that the picture in the end of this picture?
Hey, stream.
Xbox is just as easy, you just need to. They're not limited, like.
You have to sign up with somebody or something?
No, PlayStation, then why you use for their camera, Xbox are like, use any fucking camera you got. If you got, you could use your phone, you could plug your phone in. Use your phone as the camera.
PlayStation chance it? So we have to make some money after you to make money. Yep, the yellow kneeling right behind Cozy upstairs. I guess in the building.
Right, right, they're both right there.
Yeah, but they got both sorts of bars. I mean, I said that ball is
easy. Just gotta go, Julian! I mean,
Philip. Pikachu!
Find a like for the color.
Huh?
But the like for the color. It's still color.
So you can't even see the Pikachu mark anymore.
He must have done something.
It's under the beard.
I'm gonna start this where I say it.
Pika? Pika?
Well, you know, I'm gonna play. Will you play your story, fam?
Story? I haven't played story.
You don't play the story yet? You don't finish
have
it?
The game.
Oh. You know, I knew that the reason I don't finish mine is because then you get so far that night when you miss spending the night.
Oh.
I don't even. I don't know if I have to.
Philip said he may have Xbox and then we may have an Xbox chair or whatever.
We must realize that no arsenal, no weapon in the arsenals of the world.
Said we may have Xbox chair and he may buy it.
It's the will and moral courage of free men.
I didn't even feel like that.
It is a weapon our adversaries in today's world do not have.
And I'll get a check and need to jump on mobile games because he has a computer instead. I got an iPad.
No,
best
you
can do is
Call of Duty
Mobile.
He could play freaking Call of Duty. I fixed it till on my car set it up for him.
That's true. I think he said something about he's trying to set it up.
I told him I could have set it up for him. He just have to downgrade the graphics.
Let's go set it.
All of you in there, put it
You clear the move on the target.
I thought she had to go through it. Fuck, I think you need to
have to go through it. Pleasure.
Man, just eat breakfast.
Come on, Cyberpunk, you had so much fucking glitch.
But all if it is base models.
Well, of course, but I'll fix it eventually.
No, it worked good for me. PC and the Xbox One X and PlayStation 5. That's just the innovation.
Was it made for the old consoles? They just tried to make something.
They tried to make it work, but they can't handle it.
If I chop off somebody's head, I don't want them to walk up to me and give me daps.
Which one are they going to think I should get?
What are you calling him? Cody, I agree. What's the other one? I don't know, and the last one, MP5s are nice. close range though.
I can't change.
Zero.
I can't change.
Fuck.
Dipshit probably thinks he's safe. That piece of trash is a lot of things.
Safe. It's not working anymore. Once you get close to the mid range.
How's it going? They're not working. How's it going?
Take this son of a bitch alive.
Yeah, right, that goes
though. See what's in the
DVD. Whoa! You see that?
Part of my chest up there.
Well, this is a fucking giveaway my position, man.
Is that in Cold War or the Modern Warfare?
It's not Cold War.
What the hell? I never had Cold War. I didn't even play Cold War.
No, no, this. I decided getting
the story you're talking about.
Yeah, that's why I said this at the beginning of this. First time I play this. I get this from Bonnie. You show me tell you show me ask Bonnie when I'm the telepiasca. You mean I gave every all of this?
I don't remember
it. Yes, I did tell I called you I tell about the habit I
didn't
share with nobody.
And she didn't do it.
Take the shot.
What for
the
I'm not say why I don't get fucked?
Maybe if you look behind you, that's okay.
Y'all know the one that don't pick you?
That's a Captain.
Yeah, that's a
Captain. That's a
headshot, that's it.
That's not a person.
You can kill that guy. As long as it don't keep so much you got there.
Alright, I'm out. Come out with that semi-automatic. You even need nothing with a riddle. One time, one shot there, buddy.
Cause I'm gonna take that and why not nothing? I'm gonna think I'm gonna like jump on stuff, he know where it's on
rest. That was one of the bad
things. Tell me, oh, you got choices?
Sure.
I just handle the money. I have no idea where all that shit is. I don't think you understand the situation.
I think you understand now.
Rules? You have rules?
You took hostages. The rules change.
The fuck is up with homies here?
What's wrong?
What do you think? The homie was just talking. Who the fuck goes to war with that haircut?
Doc, are you a fool?
Wait, is it Turkey? He's meeting someone in trap zone every tomorrow night.
I don't like Turkey.
Oh, I swear, I don't know.
What if you interrogated him?
Call his messages.
He did. Got James.
Alright,
time
to join us
or
back.
This is
the fuck. Alright, let's move. Let's hear that intel. Hold on to the intel for now.
Hudson.
Go by the here.
He's in trap zone.
Come on out here, Clint.
I'm not coming here for the Indians. If you were leaving out Indians,
good movie star, not a fucking soldier.
You may have that scene here.
For a soldier.
Black Ops operatives, they have to blend in.
It's not a Black Ops, it's a Cold War.
It's a Black Ops.
It's a Black Ops Cold
War.
Oh, yeah.
It's a literally this are like, leave it later than the last Black Ops. So yeah, Wood's still there. That Wood's
go find this shit. Priority is to ID a Rosh.
Alright,
so we'll go
back. Yes, sir. Oh, this is the part that you've seen in the trailer. This spot sick.
That's our man.
Joining me now is the director of the National Institute of Allergy and Infectious Diseases, Dr. Anthony Fauci. Good morning, Dr. Fauci. I want to start by saying this. We report the numbers of deaths and cases every day, but I want to pause for a moment and ask you your reaction to 350,000 deaths we've now reached. Did you ever expect it to be that high?
No, Martha, I did not. But, you know, that's what happens when you're in a situation where you have surges related to so many factors, inconsistent adhering the public health measures, the winter months coming in right now with the cold, allowing people or essentially forcing people to do most of their things indoors as opposed to outdoors, and then the traveling associated with the holiday season is all of the ingredients that unfortunately make for a situation that is really terrible. I mean, to have 300,000 cases in a given day and between 2,000 and 3,000 deaths per day is just terrible. I mean, it is. I mean, there's no running away from the numbers, Martha. It's something that we absolutely got to grasp and get our arms around and turn that inflection down by very intensive adherence to the public health measures uniformly throughout the country, with no exceptions.
Dr. Fauci, the president just tweeted that the number of deaths is far exaggerated, blaming the CDC's what he called ridiculous method of determination compared to other countries. Your response to that?
Well, the deaths are real deaths. I mean, all you need to do is to go out into the trenches, go to the hospitals, see what the healthcare workers are dealing with. They are under very stressed situations. In many areas of the country, the hospital beds are stretched. People are running out of beds, running out of trained personnel who are exhausted now. That's real. That's not fake. That's real.
And Dr. Fauci, we saw that the U.S. is vaccinating only about 200,000 people a day, with many states using just a small percentage of the vaccines they have received. What's the biggest cause of this delay?
Well, I think it's just trying to get a massive vaccine program started and getting off on the right foot. There have been a couple of glitches, that's understandable. I think the important thing, Martha, is to see what's happening in the next week to week and a half, because the original projection that General Perna, who's in charge of the actual ultimate shipping and distribution, there's allocation, there's shipping, there's distribution, and then there's putting it into people's arms. So they were promising that they would have about 20 million doses that were allocated, shipped, and distributed. They fell short of that by the end of December, but in the first couple of days in January, they're catching up with that. What we need to catch up with now is getting into people's arms, because there's now about 4 million. We wanted to get to 20 million. But some little glimmer of hope is that in the last 72 hours, they've gotten 1.5 million doses into people's arms, which is an average of about 500,000 a day, which is much better than the beginning when it was much, much less than that. So we are not where we want to be, no doubt about that. But I think we can get there if we really accelerate, get some momentum going, and see what happens as we get into the first couple of weeks of January.
And Dr. Fauci, the president puts responsibility on the states, but Utah Senator Mitt Romney, as you might have just heard, wrote this week that it was unrealistic to think that healthcare workers already overburdened, or CVS and Walgreens, could really handle that vaccination program, writing that comprehensive vaccination plans have not been developed at the federal level and sent to the states as models is as incomprehensible as it is inexcusable. Is that inexcusable?
Well, what we need to do, Martha, is we've got to get interaction between the federal government and the states. To say the federal government should do it themselves, that'll never happen. To just leave the states on their own without any help, without any instruction, without any resources, is going to be tough. You've got to have a combination of both. You have to have a real interaction, a real partnership between the federal government and the states. That's what we're trying to do. Hopefully that will then materialize as we get into the beginning of this year. But you're absolutely right. If you try and do it one way or the other, it's not going to work. It's got to be pulling together, both federal and state.
We'll have a new president in a few weeks. What difference do you think the public will see when Joe Biden's president?
Well, I mean, we've already heard the president-elect Biden talking about the kinds of things that he wants to see done. And that's going to be hopefully uniform throughout the country. What the president-elect said about masks, everybody wear a mask, no exception. Everybody for the first 100 days, probably well beyond that, but at least for the first 100 days. The goal of vaccinating 100 million people in the first 100 days is a realistic goal. We can do 1 million people per day. You know, we've done massive vaccination programs, Martha, in our history. There's no reason why we can't do it right now. The classical one that people should just go back and look at, go Google it, it's really interesting. In 1947, when there was a case of smallpox of an American who was vacationing in Mexico, came back to New York City and infected a group of people. There were a total of about 12 hospitalizations and 2 deaths. New York City, in March and April of 1947, vaccinated 6,350,000 people, 5 million of which they did in 2 weeks. I was a 6-year-old boy who was one of those who got vaccinated. So if New York City,
the 117th Congress will be officially sworn in on Capitol Hill today. Before voting for its new leadership, it leaves Nancy Pelosi's fate as House Speaker on the line as Democrats' thin majority threatens her re-election.
So, Ed Snowden, a lot of people in this country are probably curious, when was the last time you had substantive discussions about coming home to the United States, and would this still be your preference? Do you still refer to it as home?
The United States will always be my home, and I'll always be willing to come back. On a single condition, and I've been quite clear about this over the years, this is that the government guarantee that I have the right, and every whistleblower has the right, to tell the jury why they did what they did. Right? We can disagree about whether this was right.
Of Senate Majority Leader Mitch McConnell was vandalized this weekend. Someone spray-painted the question, "Where's my money?" on the door of his house, an apparent reference to the $2,000 stimulus checks Leader McConnell has blocked from being passed by the Senate. On Friday, House Speaker Nancy Pelosi's home was vandalized in a similar way. Speaker Pelosi has expressed her support, though, for those stimulus checks.
The situation in many American hospitals is only getting more dire. So we begin our coverage this morning with ABC's Zorin Shah, who's in Los Angeles. Zorin, good morning to you.
The future owner of the NBA Vancouver Grizzlies.
Licensing issues with the Royal Canadian Mounted Police began play in the 1995-96 season. To build the Grizzlies from the ground up, ownership hired Stu Jackson as general manager, a former coach who would later go on to become the NBA's senior VP of basketball operations. Jackson made free agent guard and current Pacers general manager Kevin Pritchard the Grizzlies' first official signing, though he was later traded without ever suiting up for the team. Vancouver then picked up Greg Anthony and Byron Scott, among others, in the 95 expansion draft. For their first foray into the actual NBA draft, Both the Grizzlies and Raptors were hampered by a ridiculous NBA rule that prevented the two expansion franchises from selecting in the top five that year. More on that later. Anyway, in the 95 draft, the Grizzlies were behind the Timberwolves, who chose a lengthy teenage big man named Kevin Garnett at number 5, and one pick ahead of the Raptors, who selected future Rookie of the Year Damon Stoudemire. With the 6th pick, the Grizzlies selected Oklahoma State's Bryant Big Country Reeves.
With the 6th pick in the 1995 NBA draft, the Vancouver Grizzlies select Bryant Reeves from Oklahoma State University.
It's easy to laugh at that pick in hindsight, especially given how quickly Reeves' body gave out on him during his 6-year NBA career. But Big Country entered that draft as a legit 7-footer who averaged more than 21 points and 9 rebounds in leading the Cowboys to the Final Four. And for a brief few days at the start of Vancouver's inaugural season, it looked like Reeves might have found himself in another winning situation, as the Grizzlies started their inaugural NBA season with a couple of wins over Portland and Minnesota. Except, here's the thing. The Grizzlies then lost their next 19 games, and Vancouver wouldn't make it back above 500 at any time for a full 5 years. That first Grizzlies team also set a record at the time by losing 23 straight games, en route to a league-worst record of 15-67. Now, usually, that would translate to the best odds in the draft lottery. And in 1996, that would have meant the inside track on acquiring a generational talent named Allen Iverson. But remember that ridiculous rule that prevented the Grizzlies and Raptors from making a top 5 pick in the 95 draft? Well, it was actually much worse than that.
On out of the rules, the lottery is a weighted system that gives the teams with the poorest records the best chance of securing the top picks. The teams draw for those top 3 selections. The remaining positions are slotted based on regular season records. Under the terms of their expansion agreements, the Toronto Raptors and the Vancouver Grizzlies will take part in the lottery, but neither is eligible for the first pick in the draft. The best either can do is the 2nd overall pick. Therefore, among the 13 teams in the lottery, the team with the best chance of securing the first pick is Philadelphia.
And it wasn't just the 96 draft where the Grizzlies and Raptors couldn't win the number 1 overall pick. It was also the 97 and 98 drafts. For now, we go back to 96, where the Grizzlies ended up with the number 3 pick and selected future All-Star Shareef Abdur-Rahim.
The earliest a freshman has ever gone in the NBA draft, Shareef Abdur-Rahim.
As solid as Abdur-Rahim was for Vancouver, his lone All-Star appearance came years later while playing for Atlanta. At the time his name was called in the 96 draft, some of the guys still on the board included Kobe Bryant, Ray Allen, and a British Columbian native named Steve Nash. The Grizzlies trudged on, continuously inventing ways to lose during the season, then shooting themselves in the foot come the draft. They somehow managed to do worse in season number 2, going 14-68 in a tumultuous campaign that saw Jackson come down from the front office to coach after firing Brian Winters.
But you gotta keep your head up. You know, that's one good thing you can say about the Grizzlies. Even though they've got a 15-game losing streak going here, now these guys are coming out playing hard every night.
A year after the league-worst Grizzlies had to watch the Allen Iverson lottery unfold without a hope of landing him, the 1997 draft season proved even more painful. As this time, it was the Tim Duncan sweepstakes that the last-placed Grizzlies had no chance to win. Vancouver settled for the number 4 pick, which they used to select Antonio Daniels, who went on to average less than 8 points per game in only 74 games for the franchise. Jackson hired Brian Hill, who had guided the Magic to the NBA Finals only 2 years earlier, to serve as new head coach. But not much changed. Sure, Hill's Grizzlies set a new benchmark for wins in the season, but that benchmark was 19. So 3 full seasons in.
What do you guys think about when you think about where you guys came from to where you are now?
Honestly, it was fun. KD was my real, like, he was my first real friend. Like, sleepover was, like, he was the first time I ever brought my Xbox out there.
This
is Kevin Durant, perennial superstar, second pick of the 2007. As his career went downhill before it really even started. But did you know, at one point, Durant and Beasley were considered equals? They were both considered to be generational prospects who would take the NBA by storm. Two small forwards who would reinvent the position and usher in a new era of dominance. Except, only one of them did that. What the hell happened to Michael Beasley? How did he go from being in the same conversation as Durant to a journeyman, barely clinging on to his NBA career? How's it going, folks? My name's Andy, and without further ado, admitted that Beasley might have been better than himself. He stated, "I was in the gym a lot, but I wouldn't go outside and play a lot. Mike had a better feel for the game at that age than I did, because I was in the gym by myself. I was like, I want to be like that. I wanted it to come that easy. It was always easy for him." Durant also mentioned that Beasley was far more confident and outgoing than he was. So among their hometown friends, he was the guy getting all the attention from their peers. But there was something different about the young KD. This quiet, introverted kid was never the guy who wanted to step into the spotlight. Yet, when it came to sheer talent, his combination of height, athleticism, handles, his shooting prowess, he had the complete package. But for now, Beasley was still the guy to look out for. Fast forward a bit, and in college, it would be a similar story. In 2006, Durant played at Texas, where he cemented himself as a top-tier NBA prospect, finally getting the chance to show the world what he can do on the national stage. Durant finished his first and only season at Texas with averages of over 25 points and 11 rebounds a game, leading the Longhorns to a 25-10 record, eventually losing in the second round of the NCAA tournament. For this incredible season, he was named the Big 12 Player of the Year and Freshman of the Year. And in the 2007 draft, Durant would be the second overall pick. Now, everything I just said about Durant, Beasley was literally just as impressive, and he did everything that Durant did just 1 year later. In 2007, Beasley attended Kansas State, where he averaged over 26 points and 12 rebounds, and also led the Wildcats to the second round of the tournament. He would also be named both the Big 12 and Freshman of the Year, joining Durant as the only two freshmen in NCAA history to do that. And lo and behold, he would also get drafted second, the 2008 draft. Essentially, up until now, their lives, their careers have been virtually identical. Durant and Beasley were on par, on the same playing field. And all the scouts thought the same thing too. However, when their NBA career started, it became painfully clear for Beasley that he was not on Durant's level. In Durant's first few seasons, he quickly established himself as the focal point of the team. The franchise knew that too. They knew he would be the cornerstone for years to come. Since they were rebuilding anyway, there was no pressure to win. Over the years, they accumulated good players until they were ready to win games, which they did. But when it came to Beasley, the start to his NBA journey was much different. When he joined Miami, it was already an established veteran team with an established culture and identity. A few years prior, they won the NBA championship, and now they were led by Dwayne Wade in his prime. Adding a top-tier prospect, a number two pick, especially a guy as highly coveted as Beasley, it was a welcome addition. But the thing is, Beasley was not given the same opportunity to flourish like Durant was. It's a lot different joining a team trying to contend versus joining a rebuilding team like the Sonics, and having the green light to do whatever you want. Beasley was not given that green light. In fact, he wasn't even a starter. He came off the bench most of the season, averaged fewer than 25 minutes a game, and as a result, his numbers and his touches paled in comparison. This is something that people don't really talk about, and it doesn't only apply to Beasley. Year after year, we see many young players bust. But a huge reason for that isn't because they aren't talented enough, but because they just don't get drafted into the ideal situation. They're a solid franchise historically, but it just wasn't the right fit at the time. Since they were playoff contenders, he wasn't given the same amount of leeway or breathing room to make mistakes like Durant was, and that severely limited Beasley's natural development.
The Dumb Cut. Our hero simulator, and it felt nothing like it once was. OK21, Erka. So it's been a hope that you get some. It is. There's not. These guys in different jerseys. I mean, Luka in the Magic. Wait, is Jason Tatum a Maverick? Dude, Steph Curry on the Portland Trailblazers. This is foolish. Creepiest things I've ever seen. Something about this is very unsettling. I think Luka's gonna get about 14. That's what I'm saying. 14. He's missing all his shots. Only green knife. So this is nice, I guess, but I don't think this is any different from what we've had in the past. Luka's doing better than I thought he would. He's got the money rack at the end. Oh, jeez. Oh! Almost hit 24. Luka with 22. Good score. It's not looking good for Tater Tots down here. I don't know if we're going to see him in the next round or the final round. Steph Curry. Man, he looks sad as hell. Is someone pissing his cornflakes? Steph Curry, I'm predicting to win this. Well, actually, no, I'm going to win this. But if I don't, I predict Steph Curry to win. Steph Curry finishing with 25, hitting both of his deep zone balls. Klay Thompson, this is me. I have no idea how this works. What it say? It said something. Okay, here we go. Shooting. Oh, Jesus. Okay, just like this. All right. Well, it's okay. We're starting slow. We always gotta start slow. Come on. Green me, baby. Okay. That was my money rack? Oh, no. That was my money rack. The camera angle. A different than I'm used to. Green bean. We're gonna get back in him. Don't worry. If I don't get to the finals, I'm gonna be sad panda. Oh no, green. Come on, Klay. Why did my money? I pissed my money rack with someone. Green. That's a big one. That's worth how many points? That's worth 3 points. Okay. 17. Come on, please. I don't even know. Release is so weird. Green. 14. Oh, we got 20. James Harden with 23. So I'm pretty sure I'm eliminated because I don't think I have enough. No. F in the chat for I am dead. So the basket while holding R2. Bounce dunk, lob to self between the legs at a 360. What? Where's that it? Okay, that's fine. Alright. Wait, is this me? Okay, so it's free roam now. There's no commentary. There's no excitement. Going up here. Okay, damn! Almost. Let's try this again. Let's lob it up. Oh, come on. No. Zion, no. We gotta get a dunk off. Oh, yeah! That's a tank. Yeah. Hulk Hogan that. Let's see that again. Give it up. Instant replay. Look at Zion going up. There's no commentators at all. I don't have commentary off. There are no commentators. This is so weird. That's a 9.5 tank. That's 10? Dunk contest. 25! I saw it. What? 25? Out of 50? That's so racism! Oh, almost, Ja Rule, almost. Dust yourself off and try again. Oh, take a bow. He took that bow so fast. You got 31? 31? What? Where's the judges? Aaron Gordon, he's been here before, and he said he'd never come back. Let's see what he's done. I'm super confused what's going on right now. Wow, a one-handed 360. That's spicy. Why is the crowd showing no interest in this? Is it Zanny night in Baker's Life Fieldhouse? Dunk contest, 33. I'm starting to think they forgot to update this mode, and they somehow made it worse. Jason Tatum now dunking. He's not even moving. Oh, there he goes. The crowd getting behind him. And he also bows.
Link,
yeah, 25 for that. Okay, so I am tied with Jason Tatum. It is time to do this. My previous dunk was 25, and we need to do as good as we can do. I don't even know how. You can't bring props out. You can't. There's no prop option. There's nothing. There's no options at all. What the hell? Okay, his head went through the rim, so I think that should be a 50. When your head goes through the four, that was a 40? All right, Ja Rule taking the stage now. I love how they stand here for a solid 8 seconds for no reason. Oh, where's he going? Where's he going? Oh, not today. Oh, he grabbed another basketball. That's so handy there was a ball there. You gotta be... He didn't just use a... What? He did a one-handed dunk in a dunk contest. He got a 28 for a one-handed dunk. Coming from this baseline. The quarter of the audience isn't even looking in the right direction. I mean, I've seen better dunks in a game. 31. So, I can't do quick math. You don't need this, Tatum. You don't... That was a 31. This doesn't make any sense. I won the first. Is it just one round? I don't even. I won? It was one round and one round only. Are you.
Hello?
Hello? No trophy. No commentary. The most pathetic celebration ever. Sorry, it's still going. His mind is blown. Yeah, my mind is blown as well. Blowing kisses on peace signs and smacking the floor and constantly having his mind explode, I would be very scared. What am I, is it just gonna keep doing this? There's people leaving in the audience.
It's still going!
It's still going. I don't know. I don't wanna stop it. I don't wanna miss anything. How could they have made the dunk contest worse? It's worse than it was before! How can it get worse? No. Hold on. We're gonna try this again. And this time I'm gonna be Aaron Gordon. I just wanna change it up a little bit. And I know I never do that, but it loses my career. It's not even the right mode. Okay, he must get a low score.
Link on the up there. Why can't I hear you? Some fucking phone.
Never ever make it in a life. Never ever make it in a life, no plan. Never ever make it in a life. Never ever make it in a life, boy.
Thank you.
That's an awfully hot coffee pot. Should I drop it on Donald Trump? Probably not.
Let's get this stuff out of the way first. I'm not making this video to say that all white people that rap are bad. I'm obviously not saying that all white rappers are good. I just think this is a very interesting, complicated topic, and I wanted to try to give my perspective on it. I'm a white guy. Hip-hop has been by far my favorite genre for as long as I can remember. I try to make all my videos fairly without compromising my opinions while doing my proper research. And this video is going to be amazing. I've been thinking a lot about this concept of white people in rap for the past week or so. And it's for two main reasons. One, Eminem recently dropped a surprise album, and it soon became the highest rated rap album of all time by users on Metacritic. And two, I was scrolling down Twitter, I watched the music video for Jack Harlow's new song, What's Poppin', and I thought it was pretty cool. These two things may seem unimportant, but I think they both represent some of the main ideas that we'll be discussing today. So without further ado, let's begin. I've listened to Jack Harlow before, I've seen some of the buzz surrounding him, I got plenty of recommendations to check out his 2019 album Confetti, however, I was never too interested in his stuff. But when his new song and music video appeared on my timeline, I started doing these weird mental gymnastics to try and justify why I was enjoying it. Maybe I didn't like Jack, maybe I saw the Miracle Lemonade logo and it reminded me of better songs. Or maybe I didn't like Jack, I heard a fun beat and wasn't paying attention to anything else. But no, neither of those were the case. I liked Jack and I liked the song. He's charming, he had some funny lines mixed in with a couple of bars that have some meaning behind them too. His flows were solid, and he was doing a nice job riding the line between goofy and serious that seems to be growing more and more popular lately. So then once I accepted that I liked What's Poppin', I got annoyed with the fact that a second ago I was actively trying to find a reason to dislike this guy, and it's purely because he's white and he's rapping. But is that so wrong of me to do? First and foremost, rap has been a predominantly black space for its entire history. It's a genre that was built from telling their stories, their struggles, their successes. So these few decades later, sure, it's much more normal for white people to rap, now more than ever, but I think we're still in a transition period, where it's perfectly common for fans to question a white rapper's legitimacy. In my head, as a white guy, I'm fully aware of how corny and/or problematic so many white rappers can be, so over time I've generally trusted my better judgment, and I just haven't bothered with them. For anyone around my age, I think we really grew up at a time where being a white rapper was starting to become more of a genre than a coincidence. And here's what I mean by that. When you look at somebody like LP, this is a guy that has been in the game forever. He's been rapping for decades, he came from the underground and worked his way up. It took him years to find acceptance in the rap community, but he kept working and his story is inspiring and influential. He's a rapper that happens to be white. He's somebody that lives for hip-hop culture, and the color of his skin has practically nothing to do with the style and content of his music. He's not a white rapper, he's a white guy that raps. But when I was in middle school and high school, there were plenty of white rappers that were coming up, and white certainly played a role in their music and their success. They weren't trying to be accepted into the hip-hop community.
I clean up like maybe twice for the day when it gets like
appropriating the style and sounds from black artists,
and then have to let them go, because then I'll be
part of rap culture.
Cussing at them, really, up to them every 2 seconds. I'm
going to be in the entire genre for themselves, like they were sitting for Columbus discovering America. They didn't care about the roots of the music that they were playing. They took the sound and made it about themselves. That's how we got these frat boy rappers like Sammy Adams, Chris Webby, and Mike Studd, guys that weren't making rap music beats.
This video is sponsored by Skillshare. It's an online learning platform with a ton of inspiring classes built for creators like yourself. Click the link in my bio to join and get your first.
I've been watching this random shit all the time because I'm thinking about starting. I ain't got nothing else to do. Thinking about starting doing some videos too. But I'm noticing that the people that are doing good, they don't actually make the videos. They just react to them. Yeah. Those come in every day, so you got something to record, to react to every fucking day.
You have to dominate the streets. You can't let what's happening happen. Hopefully George is looking down right now and saying, this is a great thing that's happening for our country. It's a great day for him. It's a great day for everyone.
Stated views on police brutality with that line in the song, quote, and we hate the popo, want to kill us in the street, oh show.
Did you?
Please. I don't like it.
This is why I say that hip-hop has done more damage to young African-Americans than racism in recent years.
That got to be Fox News that just said that shit. Let me see, because I wasn't, let me see, right on the side.
This is why I say that hip-hop has done more damage to young African-Americans than racism in recent years.
Widely considered the most talented rapper alive. But for us to better understand his lyrics and his essence, we have to go back to the place where it all began.
Compton,
California. Kendrick Lamar Duckworth was born on June 17, 1987, to Paula and Kenny. His parents moved to Compton from Chicago a few years before his birth to escape the Southside gang culture. At the time of the move, his parents stuffed their clothes into two garbage bags and boarded a train to California with just $500 in savings. The Duckworths survived on welfare and food stamps and plugged hair for $20 a head while Kenny worked a job at KFC. Kendrick was mature from an early age, so his parents nicknamed him Man Man. He said, quote, I grew up fast as fuck. I saw my first murder at age 5, when a teenage drug dealer was gunned down outside our apartment. After that, you just get numb to it. His mother said Kendrick was always a loner. He was always in the corner of the room watching. Although his family was impacted by the violence of the streets, Kendrick has a lot of fond memories of childhood, where he enjoyed riding his bike, doing backflips off his friend's roof, and sneaking into the living room during his parents' house parties. His most distinct childhood memory is sitting on his dad's shoulder at age 8, watching Dr. Dre and Tupac shoot a video for the song, California Love.
And I remember being on my father's shoulders and just really watching Tupac yelling at the police because they were about to scratch the side of his car on their motorcycle bikes. I remember all that. Yeah, he was definitely putting on a show for us.
Tupac became a major source of inspiration for a young Kendrick. Although Pac was murdered in a drive-by shooting at the young age of 25, he's widely considered one of the most gifted hip-hop lyricists of all time. He was known for his charisma and outspoken persona that challenged white supremacy, discrimination, and injustice.
This world is such a gimme. Everybody back off. You know, everybody might be taught that from school, everywhere. Big business, you want to be successful, you want to be strong, gimme, push. Step, crush. There's too much money here. I mean, nobody should be getting a lotto for $36 million and we got people starving.
I just realized that, like, lately, why is this? There's like 200 fucking pictures of. What's up?
Kendrick also found inspiration from Biggie, Jay-Z, Eminem, and the local hip-hop group that reached worldwide recognition, N.W.A. Becoming a rapper wasn't clear-cut for Kendrick. As late as middle school, he had a noticeable stutter. When in 7th grade, his life changed, when an English teacher turned him on to poetry. Lamar said, quote, "You could put all your feelings down on a sheet of paper, and they'd make sense to you." At home, he started writing non-stop. His dad used to think he was doing homework, but really he was writing lyrics. By the time high school came around, Lamar was running around with a bad crowd, and he had several run-ins with the police, and they pulled a gun on him on 2 separate occasions. He said, quote, "There were a few good cops who were actually protecting the community, but then you have ones from the valley. They never met me in their life. But since I'm a kid in basketball shorts and a white t-shirt, they want to slam me on the hood of the car." Kendrick took his angst and frustration and applied it to his lyrical craft, which he honed in rap battles after school. Who knows what you best to call a doctor? I make sure the rookie man of the service can hop up. Bring it on, pistol whip and break the pace on it. Shit, I done it my way like Sinatra. I let the infrareds down, we should touch your scope and spot you. Move on and I catch you. Do my vision like the radio. Creep into your house, you hear footsteps. Slowly as I tiptoe. My wise like my pops, but I'm young motherfuckers. This is the point of the story where we should introduce Anthony Top Dog Tippett, a former gangster who was born and raised in the Green neighborhood of Watts. When he turned 30, his mom passed away, and he made a decision himself to give up street life and try to make it in the music space. So he bought equipment and built a studio in his apartment.
It started in 97 when Top built the studio into the back of the
wanted to do all the video.
You know, we built it built into about 2004. That's where the roster came in that we got now.
In a big way, they modeled their label after Death Row Records, which was founded in 1991 by Suge Knight and released iconic albums under artists like Dr. Dre, Snoop Dogg, and Tupac.
We absolutely followed the motto of Death Row.
You know me talking about the way I called Donut? You know,
right there in our backyard, so we kind of seen Donut. How it goes.
No? He from Miami?
I mean, so that was easy. Man. Yeah, the star, that street credibility.
J-Rock was the first artist signed by Top Dog Entertainment, and a few months after that, Top found out about a 16-year-old who went by K-Rock that had some local buzz from his first mixtape.
That what you mean, kid?
You're
in charge.
I'm not.
In their first meeting together, Kendrick had approved himself.
But I mean, not the first time, but 10 years ago.
And freestyle for a half straight.
Dread, that Spanish valley, dreads don't play out. Fucking grills.
And got to work. Top Dog said, quote, "Growing up in the era of gangster shit, a lot of my friends were killed. A lot were in jail. I got shot. When I got with the PDE artists, it was up to me to show them something different. To lock them in the studio and
build a bond with their brothers.
Kendrick said, quote, "I was hungry, man. The summer I came over there, everyone was getting murdered. There was a real war with my section and teenagers in the world. Crime is small, so we're warned on the corners. By the grace of God, we found the studio." A crucial factor in Kendrick's development was the fact that the studio was free. Lamar said a lot of homies go to studios and they've got to rush their verses before somebody else comes in. I was able to do a verse, scrap it, do it over, and perfect my whole thing. And that gave me the upper hand among other artists. After YHNIC, he dropped 3 additional mixtapes, Training, No Sleep Till NYC, and C4. His time in the studio was paying off. Every new release represented a significant step forward in his progression as a rapper and artist. However, up to this point, he hadn't gotten too personal in his music. So on his next release, he changed his artist name from K-Dot to Kendrick Lamar.
"I want people to know who I am as a person and what I represent. So I woke up one morning, I said, the best way to start it off is giving me my name change, my real name. Someone my mother been calling me for years. What is an artist? You know what I mean? If you don't know who they are, the biggest people you felt like you can relate to their story, like the Tupac, Biggie, you know what I mean, Nas, Jay, you know what I mean? So I just basically want to pattern myself after that and step up to the next level and mature, you know?"
This is around the time that Kendrick began to think TDE could really take off in the music industry.
Well, the first moment was making noise when Rock had to sign with Lil Wayne all my life. Okay.
It's like, we all know.
Yeah, that's it. That's the, you know, that's the moment, like, yo, this really can happen, you know what I'm saying?
I was a pillar with a silver spoon. Child in the ghetto raised off a different tone. Watch it, I walk in my living room. If the price is right, I can get you the whole nigga room. The
second moment for me was my first show downtown, like, my first
coming!
Man, how many people?
How many people? About 300.
There you go.
Yeah,
you
I was like, man, yeah, this is that.
Check it out, I used to wanna rap like Jay-Z, until I finally realized that Jay wasn't me. I took my time to jot down every line that's affordable. Critics say I don't be killing this shit, but I know I do.
This song is on the Kendrick Lamar EP, which dropped on December 31, 2009, and earned over 100,000 downloads. It's a shame most people don't know about this project. It certainly didn't get the major attention it deserved, but you guys should check it out on YouTube. There are some absolute gems on here. Although this project didn't circulate far and wide, it still created enough of an underground buzz that there was real expectations surrounding his next work. On September 14, 2010, Kendrick dropped his fourth solo mixtape, Overly Dedicated. While the Kendrick Lamar EP introduced him, Overly Dedicated showed the world a more refined and polished rapper. In many ways, this project foreshadows the artist he would grow to become. The song playing right now, Ignorance is Bliss, was Dr. Dre's introduction to Kendrick Lamar.
It was the first time Dre ever heard Ignorance is Bliss video, which is a great introduction. If I had to pick any of the songs, it would be that or The Heart, part two. You heard Ignorance is Bliss, called my dude Top Dog immediately. Same day, Top called me and was like, yo, Dre just heard his review.
Yes, sir.
Dr. Dre's co-sign gave Kendrick instant credibility, and it also allowed the world to see the other artists and producers linked to Top Dog in the same. So having released several mixtapes and an EP, it was time for his first studio album. On July 2nd, 2011,
you want the big one?
On Section 80, Lamar shows us his worldview. He dives into the dangers of a generation that fell victim to the crack era, and he raps about the self-hatred and hopelessness that often inflicts citizens of inner cities. One of my favorite tracks on the joint is Rigor Mortis, where he shows us his crazy rapping ability. This video is brought to you by Skillshare. The first 1,000 people to use the link in my description will get a free.
I hit on that event. I'm not going to go back to. Hey, there's a video on any and everything you could possibly think about on this freaking thing.
Yes.
All right.
Uncle
gave
you more than Netflix. I know.
He made a video where he like recapped
the whole
year.
Oh, yeah?
Like,
I think I've seen one of those. I've seen recently there's this Jamaican dude reacting to Belizean music. Like new. Yeah. think it's that same dude. Alright, see there too. Oh fuck, I missed it. Yeah, all of these are the leaders, huh? Yeah.
Right,
come here. Damn,
that's all right here, slap.
Which one?
Your trust friend.
Mm.
None of them are fear and them. Tell them your friend and them are fear and some shit. Can't trust them because they must stay on.
Yeah.
Chat to business, spread rumor about.
You guys been recommending this for a long, long while, but y'all know for so many videos, guys, I gotta spread them out and give them to me one by one. But guess what? Keep spamming them, that's a good thing. Like up the video, comment on this video to see your comment in the next video that I post. And if you all are new to the channel, you're not already subscribed to the channel. We're on the road to 40,000 subscribers, so you need to steam your mother, your auntie, your brother, your sister, your uncle, your granny, your grandpa, your nephew. Everybody you know, your friend and your bonham man, your man, your hey, subscribe to the channel. We're like 900 subscribers away from
40. Jamaicans when they talk, they sound like they sing just when they talk. Just that, dude, that shit sound good, man. Like, I don't know, like, most of the time, even me, I listen to Creole and this shit all my life, and I still sometimes can't understand what the fuck they say, but shit sound good, so I'm like, yeah, man. I just like, yeah, man. Unruly. That's Jamaican as Pop Khan, but Pop Khan's company is now signed to OVO. So he, by extension, he's with like Drake and them. He posted a picture recently with him and Drake. I'd say careful, cause all Drake does is they become friendly with all the new artists, and steal all their shit, all the new vibes, all the things, or pay them. Dude was crying because he said he came up with like six of the songs that Drake has that are number one, and he gets paid $500 to hang out in the studio with them. And he was happy. He was happy for that, but then they in the studio and shit, anything they come up with in there while they it's But he was going to go public and then he just all of a sudden quiet. One of them was Quentin Miller and the other dude, I don't remember the other dude's name, but he was gonna he was gonna tell, like legit, like he was gonna spill the whole beans what goes on in they call it the OVO sweatshop. But I guess they probably gave him some money and he just like, he was cool. He was cool after that.
Same thing with all
these cats,
baby, all
of them. They trying to stay relevant, like, especially if you got all the artists. You, the way how you flow, no really change, or the way you think for right, no really change. Then you think you have to fucking go. All right, oh shit, they doing it like that now. Okay, I have to figure that shit out, or else I'll get fucking left behind. But I mean, they fucked up because then it can't get it right. But because the other day, I just said that. Lil Wayne may need money. He sell all of them the master recordings to one of them big company for $100 million. So now somebody own all of Drake work with me do on the Young Money. Somebody own that.
Oh, Lil Wayne sold
them. Yeah.
His and Drake.
Yeah.
That's crazy. So no royalties, remember. Thank me later and all that.
That's crazy. All of them ones where he was saying Young Money. I think it's probably Nicki's too. Well, I don't think North Nicki's still there, bro. I heard nothing from her in a while. Better be careful. I know her body could expand with all that plastic.
That makes sense. She'd probably be on the line like she's pretty. Funny as fuck. Like, it's real crazy.
This nigga has a friend on a cross. You see that friend?
Okay, but he's real.
Yes. Went on the homework till I come back, right? And like last night. I'll do it later. So I did a version of this for the show too. This song? the same dude did. It's
what is this
Lincoln.
What is this all? What is that all?
Timmy.
What is that all? What is that all?
Lincoln named. Some kind of chihuahua mix with some
wiener dog chihuahua.
It's scaring my dad. Is that right? Dad, the only reason Timmy got like you is because remember the last time when Alicia was here? And that kid is that because you were having to be a
wife. So you said I got big head. If I got big head, you got big head. You got big head. Yeah, that's what somebody's saying. A wiener dog with a no, it's definitely a chihuahua. So that shit might not grow much bigger than that. That shit hasn't grown since it got here, like a month. It's just like it's been here like a month, and that shit hasn't grown no bigger. It probably is a wiener and a fucking chihuahua. So that shit ain't just, that shit just gonna go like, it ain't gonna get no taller, and this shit just gonna go, get longer.
A wiener chihuahua.
Yeah, that's what they should have called him. Timid instead of Timmy.
Okay. I got a homeboy named Timmy.
And that's the same girl in the...
He used to beat up his big brother, he beat up a lot of people, right? This little square white boy. I'm talking about, if you ever seen him.
Let's just say,
hey, man. That's how you talk, right? No, y'all see me crazy. He was like, hey, man, sorry, I got something to tell you. I said, what is it? He said, I'm black. I started laughing. Is he a white boy? We used to hang out with blacks, so we're my best kid ever. But in prison, he used to bring out the white boys.
He was
ashamed to tell me.
Oh, so he was like, yo, okay.
I'm white. I started laughing because he's white. He's like, I'm white. I'm like, what the fuck is that? Hey, you get it, y'all, for a second, right? He started laughing.
I was like, please follow me and say my tattered lines, okay?
When I first met him, he was trying to laser at me and my homeboy. We tried to beat him up. He was seeing his brother, and we was talking to the door. Like, just open the door. Don't trip and open the door. Man, being the homie years later, right?
Yeah.
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 That's
yeah.
Cool.
Yeah.
That's the same girl from the last video. He probably really liked that chick.
Girl like this walking around your house with no bra on, and she just real rude. She's just walking, casually walking, and the boobs are jumping. You know she's a keeper. Like you know she's a keeper. She's just casually walking.
Oh, wow. I peeped that just now though. I did peep that when she walked by. Right here, right. But her boobs ain't even that big. But what, look, you gonna see them move though when they see.
Walking around your house with no bra on, and she just barely moving. She's just walking, casually walking, and the boobs are jumping. You know she's a keeper. Like you know she's a keeper. She's just casually walking. Oh, wow.
Right, right, right. Get me up, 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 get me
seen that shit before. Wait, that says Hennessy wine?
Yeah, it
says Hennessy. White.
Pure white.
Oh yeah, I seen the white, yeah. Is that my shit? So why the fuck I wanna go bust my ass out there to go pay a babysitter? Best thing I just stay my ass home.
Yeah,
I get looks like
that. That's me, yeah. Work on like that sometimes.
Gotta be part of the street, kid. Gotta be part of the street.
stream.
He want cream too. He want pink one.
He want the stream.
He want be. He want have pink one. He tell me that for years now. That me the sleep on it, cause I don't see King ready for that. And he like talk.
So wait, what's a stream?
He say want if he want be a streamer.
Papa John, they got Sting.
He want
stuff.
He knows. He know where to talk, bro. Stream games, video, like be a YouTuber.
Video and talk on the
same
way you play.
Silent.
You ever hear me silent? You must say you have to mute me.
That's like saying silent in backstage.
You must say you have to mute. You can't play. Like when we play, and I make you play for me sometimes as he gets my. He start talking, he don't stop talking. I don't care what you say, just things like that. I like, when I give up the mic, but he? Hey, any out there? Hello? I have to message you. Hey, what the fuck, why up? But I had to mute your son, man. I can't
pointers?
What? No, I just meant to show me that people that react to Belizean videos, no? From other places? They have a Belizean videos like Jamaicans and that too.
Yeah, the best for you in music when I
hook up. Oh shit. hold on. But you heard the song from before? You've heard his first song?
No, but that was...
Hold on. Hear the first one first before I go to that. His name is Chocolate.
Yeah.
Oh shit. Oh my bad.
This nigga's retarded.
And he really be like that. I met him in Corozal.
That's Blippi. And that was our wife.
In Corozal?
Yeah. Chocolate.
What do you mean what? He really be like that?
He acts like that.
That's a fire?
He's crazy. He acts like that. He that's him. Shit, wait.
Why is it official music?
Yeah.
That shit said official music
video. Because it is his official music video.
It is.
Where?
He made it himself. Huh?
Alright, this is the first one. This is the first one.
Baila amiga. Baila amiga. Dale, 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 hombre. Dale, 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 dale. Ella quedó con chocolate.
That's why this one was unofficial. He stepped up since then.
I didn't even know you could be worse though. Alright, let's turn this one off.
Well, you getting uncomfortable, Julia? Wait,
I feel like we watched the
Google Gaga, this right there. This is the new one. You see, this one's in the high dip.
He's got a shirt on most of this one.
Hey, this shit came out what, 2 days ago?
It's probably viral.
Oh, the first. That shit already got 10K, bro. On Facebook, it has like 80. It has like 80 on Facebook. Because nobody don't normally go, because you can watch it straight off of Facebook, right?
So serious rappers don't even get them kind of views. Okay,
skills, wish
he could get
views. Yes. Hey, that's what I said. We can hit 500 as much as we want, but this nigga.
Probably making 10,000, that's enough to make money from the place.
maybe like a couple hundred.
No, I think 100 at least.
Oh, yeah, look, maybe a little.
He's got 80 you said on Facebook.
Wait, don't stop lying at theater.
I had to ask somebody what my that means.
Whitney.
It's maestro. There's a female version. Female teacher. Wait, you came at the worst time. We're not actually listening to this, we're laughing at it, alright? Just so you know. I don't want you to come in here thinking this is our vibe.
Bye. I got a video to go shoot in an hour.
Kind of video.
The comedy show they have when I stream from Sector 9.
Yeah.
But they have a musical performance and I have to go record that.
David and David?
Huh?
David?
Who's David?
David Morey from Creek.
No, that was last week. There's new people now.
This is a long ass fucking song.
It's like, what the fuck are y'all?
I explained this. It's a the fucking out. Some Blasian artist that just fucking did some stupid ass shit that actually went viral. It just came out like 2 days ago.
This is how he is though. I met this dude and he acts the same way. He's
something for
a cartoon character. Straight up. He is literally walking around doing that shit with his chest. Yeah, he's taking this shit is serious.
You get more views than this fucking serious fucking rappers out here. The guy's actually trying to do it.
You lucky you missed the first one.
Oh yeah, definitely lucky. Don't put it back on.
Wait, he has 54 minutes of him this verse.
We don't want to see 54 minutes of him.
Nah. Coconut? Wait, hold on, I never heard this one.
Agua, 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 agua. Nice seaside on the coconut. Nice seaside on the coconut. I want the cocoa, she want the nut. For coconut.
That's enough, I'm done.
She had to go for it, I got it.
Yo. No, but that shit's going viral on Facebook.
Loving God, he's here. That's
a who's here?
Timmy.
Tamer.
Loving God. He's here.
Mom, you're trying to make it. Mom, just see, there's
no. Is that thing going to get any bigger?
Yeah. Mom said, trying to send me a TikTok. I just meant to tell her to, like, God, when he called me, I said, because I got two people with him. Wait, send me the dressing on butter.
Uncle, it's not macaroni. So you don't need the
yes, I got macaroni for you.
Macaroni, Dad?
That thing can't grow?
What? I don't think so. You don't get moving. Yes, I do have
some food for you. Yes, I'm looking for one. Wife lets you leave the house?
I don't work.
Whose kid was it?
Not no work, so.
Daddy, whose kid was that?
Daddy, can you please tell Candace a celebrity that someone
Jay?
Take the moon. Don't tell Candace a celebrity that
somebody
will
feel us. You want out? So I know you love macaroni. Yes, I'm going to give you out. If you don't know, you're going to come back and ask some more. You want me to carry it over there for you?
No.
You don't want no chicken?
No.
Oh, you got a full plate there, buddy. I don't know if you can handle that.
That's a macaroni. That's a whole plate.
He can't handle that.
That's
a full plate. You know what I'm saying? Don't worry about it.
Nice.
You know what I learned today?
What's that?
All like skinny motherfuckers look alike.
That's so good.
What are you trying to say? You and I are about the same complexion.
Yeah, but we ain't light skinned. No motherfuckers light skinned.
Oh, I thought you were trying to include me in this.
Daddy, can you
please
talk to the celebrity that somebody was screaming?
Yeah. Just telling him that this shit is done.
They wouldn't really like that.
You didn't know any though?
I gotta say.
I heard.
It's Black Cards Matter.
Well, what happened? They shut him down?
He said to me,
I shit.
I remember that.
On that show.
I remember that.
He got canceled. Not by the culture, not by anything. He got canceled by the freaking company, by Viacom. Normally it's a community I cancel you.
You wanna grab a Levo?
What they're about to do.
It's up to you, I don't care. I'm down. Whatever.
Hey,
I think.
Do you have sex in person? Need somebody?
What are you going to get?
All
right. I'll see you tomorrow.
I just heard Lo say you was Russian?
Yes.
That's crazy, because I'm Russian too.
Oh,
yeah. Yeah, I'm rushing to get you home and take them clothes off.
You said that, man. Whoa, buddy.
All over you.
What's up, Booze? You heard that stereotype about Asian dudes, right? It's true. We do eat the cat.
It's fine. Just let it move.
Ladies don't care about the Brooklyn Nets. But we might want to see them Brooklyn Nuts.
What's up?
Give me a break. Just give me a break. Ambiguous makes believe.
What's up, baby? You remind me of the 20 letters in an alphabet.
There's 26 letters in an alphabet.
Silly me. I set out to get the U R-A-Q-T.
You know,
Killa. Please sit down and eat your food, though. Video game character.
Alright, so I bet you $100 I can kiss you without touching you.
Okay.
Okay.
Let's
see.
You kiss her?
Yeah. Yeah, sure. You now gotta grab something too.
Summer, what's up, baby? Looking amazing. Now, you know us white people. We love hockey. Ice hockey. Roller hockey. Tonsil hockey.
Yeah, I be roasted, make it be clipped. Y'all know my slogan.
like freestyling in the whole thing though. She,
man, they done killed her off so many times.
Yeah, but she got like freestyle. I'm talking about freestyle. They write shit for her. She literally comes off the top.
You got my own? I put my cell and I'll play my cards. You don't know what I'm prison. You don't have any bars.
Bars, I ain't going to jail. I ain't getting caught. I'm a snitch.
Well, I need my parole. I've been a bad boy. I should go to the hole.
There,
go to the hole. A nice one in the hole. But it's me and you.
I wanted some coconut water, but they look spoiled.
I had me arrested. I'm f***ing it up until I catch a domestic.
Yeah, he said they look spoiled.
Now you in prison, but
that's up to me, Cleaver. Yeah? Yeah, they look cloudy instead of clear.
The topic is police. Pick up and kill it and kill it and kill it. Pick up and kill it, you know I don't trust ya. Since I'm a cop, I think I might kill ya. I am not small, I might just hurt ya. You under arrest, now let me come and search ya.
You said you were cop, but no, I don't need help. I will ride you all night long with no seatbelt. Okay now, officer, you think you nice thing. I will let you come meet me with your nice thing.
Be with the nice thing, I heard what you said. Turn you around, just spread your legs.
I spread my legs, okay, I get it, but what can I do to get it? But you just look stupid with those slides on. I know you ain't hooping. You ain't no athlete. I know you was broken. What the f have you been smoking?
Some of these battles are getting real. People be getting fired on these.
I think Carl battle. Which one you said?
I'm in our head with
them
wild, wild thoughts.
Carl Meek, I think, got fired. Three, four, six. Oh, shit. All right.
I got literally enough cups to start on bar. Because literally I'm a bad cup to start on bar. But I know you really use
so
good
when
cup.
I asked you to tell you, like, what?
When I use it, I tell you I have to go wash cups. Oh, and then underneath this thing, I don't bring up the new cups anymore. I don't want some necklace. They can just mess everything in your cup.
What?
my soldiers, stand at attention. Stand at attention.
Hey, yo, DC, what's up? Get fly on your girl like Duck Wing Duck. Duck Wing Duck, that's a no. I'm getting your girl this bottle like a Flintstone.
Tell you a story about the Fuji. Since you said the Fuji, I get ill. I'ma take you to the top like that. Lauryn Hill, get it? Like Lauryn Hill, back on the pill. He kept it real, so we gon' rock it. Roof ain't gon' stop it. You know how we do, we get it poppin'. We get it poppin', we get it unstoppin'. Speaking of the pop, this is how Clef rock it. P-O-P, that is pop. Why Clef Sean, I rep that hip hop.